In this segment, we will finish forecasting the income statement and then turn to the current operating assets, cash, receivables, and inventories. Forecasting interest expense can be simple or complicated depending upon how precise you want this number to be in your forecast. The easiest way to forecast interest is to assume that any new borrowings take place at the beginning of the year and there are no changes to the principal balance throughout the year. Then, interest expense can be calculated as the forecasted rate times the balance in long-term debt. Clearly, this is a pretty restrictive assumption and probably not the most realistic for most firms. However, to make this estimate more precise would require a detailed projection of debt balances, by month at the very least, along with all the scheduled payments and new loans. Since investors and analysts usually don't have this kind of detail, I will use the simple approach. As can be seen from NEBCO's balance sheet and from their leverage and debt equity ratios, NEBCO has a pretty good chunk of debt by the end of their first year, over $800,000 of long-term debt, compared to only $752,000 of owner's equity. Financial leverage of 2.7 and total debt to equity of 1.66 are not outrageous, but probably higher than management would like. So for the purpose of the forecast, let's assume that NEBCO's management wants to lower the amount of leverage or debt by making payments of $228,000 on their long-term debt. This will bring the balance down to $600,000, and with a forecasted interest rate of 8%, interest expense is forecasted to be $48,000. In projecting income tax expense, the main decision is whether to use an estimate of the firm's effective tax rate or the statutory tax rate. The effective tax rate is an average tax rate that takes into account the various tax planning and tax reduction strategies employed by the firm and is calculated by dividing income tax expense by earnings before income taxes. While there are differences of opinion about where and when to use either the effective or statutory tax rates, using the statutory rate is the simplest approach and should work fine in most circumstances. In the United States, the federal tax rate tops out at 35%, which is the rate you'll often see in a forecast. For NEBCO, our year two forecast of earnings before taxes is $228,000. Multiplying that by 35% gives us income tax expense of $80,000 and net income of $149,000. Income tax expense is usually the last item that needs to be forecasted to complete your income statement. Notice how all the expenses are in some way derived from our initial forecast of sales revenue. We'll see that this logic carries over to many of our balance sheet items as well. Before we begin forecasting the balance sheet, I should point out that one of the problems when forecasting a balance sheet is getting the statement to balance when you're done. Like the income statement, we project the balance sheet by forecasting each line item individually, based on its relationship to sales, other expenses, or some other planned initiative of the company. Thus, the forecasted total assets amount is not likely to equal the total of liabilities plus stockholders' equity, which means we need to have a plan as to how we're going to balance the balance sheet. If assets exceed liabilities and stockholders' equity, well, this means we need more financing to pay for the increase in assets, which means we'll need to borrow more funds or increase owners' investment. If liabilities and stockholders' equity exceed assets, this means we'll have more financing than we need and we'll need to make a decision about what, if anything, to do with the excess cash. We'll discuss this decision at the end of our forecast. Let's talk about cash. Cash could be the balancing account in our forecast, setting it equal to whatever is needed to balance out the balance sheet. However, doing this could lead to a negative cash amount. That can be confusing to some people, so I prefer to forecast cash directly as a percent of sales. A good rule of thumb is to forecast cash between 1% and 3% of sales, since firms try to keep their cash balances as low as possible, but still have enough on hand to pay for day-to-day operating expenses. Anything more than that is usually invested to earn a return. For NEBCO, we'll forecast cash at 1% of forecasted sales. The level of accounts receivable depends on your sales forecast and should also take into account any initiatives underway to accelerate collections from customers. Thus, one way to project receivables is as a percentage of sales based on past relationships. However, since many firms do employ various working capital best practices that target a specific accounts receivable turnover ratio, or days in receivables, receivables can be forecasted based on either of those ratios as well. For example, the accounts receivable turnover ratio can be calculated as sales divided by accounts receivable. Rearranging this ratio leads to accounts receivable is equal to sales divided by the accounts receivable turnover ratio. In this way, you can project receivables based on the sales forecast and a target turnover ratio the firm wants to achieve. At NEBCO, we see that during their first year, they had a receivables turnover of 6.9 times a year, or every 53 days. While they would like to increase the receivables turnover, which is the same as reducing the days in receivable, this can be unrealistic for a startup company that's trying to grow sales and market share. So let's assume for NEBCO that there'll be a slight drop in the receivables turnover ratio in year two, from 6.9 to 6.5. This will lead to an increase in accounts receivable from $450,000 to $515,000. Inventory can be forecasted along the same lines as accounts receivable, either as a percent of sales or based on the inventory turnover ratio. The formula for forecasting inventory based on the inventory turnover ratio is inventory is equal to the cost of goods sold divided by the inventory turnover ratio. The exact same approach we use when forecasting receivables based on the receivables turnover ratio. Following the same logic we use for receivables, we can assume that NEBCO will not be able to increase inventory turnover at a time when they are trying to accelerate their growth and expand production. Thus, we will forecast a decrease in the inventory turnover ratio from 6 to 5.2. This will lead to an increase in inventory from $350,000 to $412,000.